on this Labor Day weekend. I thought everyone was at the beach.
Yesterday.
Yesterday. Okay. Well, this morning, I'm delighted to welcome you here to Christchurch. And we're pleased that you're joining us here on the web via Facebook. I pray that the service will be a blessing to you here and to those who are joining us on the web. This is Labor Day. This is the weekend that we recognize those millions, thousands of people who keep this country going each and every day. And we are so grateful to you and to them, and all of those who are involved in this country. And so we begin this morning with a prayer. This is the day that the Lord has made. This is the day when he can be found. God of all, breath of life, living water, Savior friend. Come as the hungry feed on his word. Come as the thirsty drink of his love. Come as the faithful worship the Lord. Would you please stand and let us sing our opening hymn, Joyful, Joyful, We Adore Thee.
Praise.
Jesus.
Thanks be to God.
The psalm appointed for today is Psalm 119, 33, verses 33 through 40. Let us read responsibly by half verse. We will begin and end with a refrain. Make me go to the path of your commandments, but that is my desire. Teach me, O Lord, the way of your statutes,
and I shall keep you to the end.
Give me understanding, and I shall keep your law.
I shall keep it with all my heart.
May he go in the path of your commandments.
For that is my desire.
Incline my heart to your decrees.
And not to unjust gain.
Turn my eyes from watching what is worthless.
Give me life in your ways.
Fulfill the promise to your servant,
which you make to those who fear you.
Turn away the reproach which is dread,
because your judgments are good.
Behold, I long for your commandments.
In your righteousness preserve my life.
May it go in the path of your commandments, but that is my desire. Glory to our Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. The second reading is from the book of Romans, the 13th chapter, the 8th through the 14th verse. Owe no one anything except to love one another. For the one who loves another has fulfilled the law. The commandments: you shall not commit adultery, you shall not murder, you shall not steal, you shall not covet, and any other commandments are summed up in the word, love your neighbor as yourself. Love does no wrong to a neighbor. Therefore, love is the fulfilling of the law. Besides this, you know what time it is, how it is now the moment for you to wake from sleep. For salvation is nearer to us now than when we became believers. The night is far gone, the day is near. Let us then lay aside the works of darkness and put on the armor of light. Let us live honorably as in the day, not in reviling and drunkenness, not in debauchery and licentiousness, not in quarreling and jealousy. Instead, put on the Lord Jesus Christ and make no provision for the flesh to gratify its desires. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Yes.
Okay. Would you please stand and let us sing our sequence hymn, Seek Ye First.
Ah!
gonna give you a little talk too. It may pinch you. It may, I don't know. For the past 2 weeks, I have been focusing on Paul's letter to the Romans. In the two passages we read, Paul showed us how to live a truly authentic life. One where we conform to his way of living, and the other, loving in a genuine way. I thought I would move away from Paul and go to the gospel reading for today. And guess what? Jesus is talking about that authentic life. However, he's going to teach us how we can still live that authentic life when it has been rocked by a disagreement, by conflict in the church. And no one tell me that they have never experienced conflict in the church. There is conflict in the churches. What is Jesus' motive behind doing this? What is Jesus' mission? He's building a community. He's building the kingdom of God. It would be rather unfortunate if everyone in the kingdom of God had a problem with each other. The kingdom is now forced to stop its direction and handle the conflict within its community. This will severely hamper its mission. The Christian life is not always singing hallelujah. There are moments when hurtful words are said, when words are misinterpreted, when feelings are hurt. The most common reaction is to run and tell someone else, not the person who did the wrong. And then the festering starts. And this is where Jesus jumps in today. First, Jesus says, go pull the person aside and tell them how they made you feel. He did not say, tell off the person in front of others. He said, when the two of you are alone. In my prideful days, I have found this very difficult to do. In looking back, I wish I had pulled the person aside. I was not brought up to confront. And in the past, when I confronted, it all came out the wrong way. I am probably still guilty of this. We all find it difficult to address conflict. Notice that Jesus is telling us that you, the person who has been wrong, should make the first move. Be the first one to go reconcile with the other. Make the first attempt to tell the person how you feel. I have always heard that it is not so much what is said, but rather how the person made you feel. Secondly, if the person listens to you and you have each come to an agreement and you start a friendship again, that is wonderful. However, if the person would not listen to you, take two or three persons with you so they may hear what is being said and what has led to this disagreement. Even at this point, Jesus is not willing to give up on that person. This person is not to be ridiculed or shamed, but rather, if the person is still not listening and reconciled, then tell it to the church. In my 21st century mind, I could see this person coming forward one Sunday morning and telling the church of the incident that caused this disagreement. So one of the things and I can only speak on behalf of the Episcopal Church, is that this is something that is confidential. It is something that is kept in private. I don't know if other denominations open it up to the entire church, but usually it is kept within the church. And so Matthew, when you think of why Matthew is saying this, is that he's in
in the first century house churches. And so to stand up in front of 10 people and say, we have a problem, the two of us have a problem, is not as bad as when you're going to stand up in front of an entire church here in the 21st century and tell everyone about it. I think there's a time and place for that. In our church today, we are actually telling the incident either to a bishop or to a priest. And we carry out the rite of the reconciliation of a penitent. Have you ever heard of that? Of that rite? In this rite, the bishop or the priest would absolve the penitent after they have confessed and are remorseful about their grievance. And this is part of the prayer that the person says. Therefore, O Lord, from these and all other sins I cannot now remember, I turn to you in sorrow and repentance. Receive me again into the arms of your mercy and restore me to the blessed company of your faithful people. So he's asking to be received and be forgiven by Jesus and to be received by us in the church. Ultimately, this is what Jesus wants to achieve by the reconciliation, that the person be restored to the church, to the community. And so you have homework. You may not have prayer books at home, but you do have the BCP online.org, page 447 to 452. Take a look at it. You know, because it goes through the entire rite, the entire prayers, and rite is R-I-T-E. The entire rite of how this is done, how the person confesses, and how they are absolved of this incident. Do we as a church also play a role in the reconciliation? And I would say yes, we do. What if someone did come to you and tell you about a disagreement they had with someone? In our role as laity, we are to carry on Christ's work of reconciliation in the world. And this is also found in our prayer book. You become one of the two who will listen to the incident which has caused the hurt. Again, notice there's no excommunication, no shunning. The whole idea is to reconcile the person or persons to the church. Someone once said, reconciliation means burying the hatchet, not burying the issue. The issue you keep talking about, but disagree agreeably. Walk hand in hand without necessarily having to see eye to eye. Prior to verse 15 of this chapter, and that's sometimes why I don't like our lectionary, because it skips so much. But prior to this passage, Jesus tells the story of a man who owns 100 sheep. Remember that story? And one wanders off, so he's left with 99. And he leaves the 99 on the hill and go after the one that was lost. And many people think, well, why didn't he just let that one go? And Jesus says, no, I must go and get that one back. Because he knows the 99 are safe, but he doesn't know about that one. So each person deserves to live in a community of believers, free from conflict and upheaval. Then Jesus adds a statement that puzzles me. And if the offender refuses to listen even to the church, let such a one be to you as a Gentile and a tax collector. Now, we have this double thing here. To the Jewish people, the Gentiles were unclean. The tax collectors were skimming them for money. So what they wanted nothing to do with either two. But Jesus went after both. So why is he saying let such a one be to you as a Gentile and a tax collector. So I thought of, if you have tried and tried and tried and tried, and you still cannot get this person to listen to you, Jesus is saying, leave them alone. Leave them alone. At least that's my interpretation of it. Leave them alone. Because that person has been hurt too. Usually when two people have a problem, both persons are hurt. And not everyone is willing to come forward readily to forgive, often far less to reconcile. But I think Jesus is asking us to try again, because he tried again several times to win over the Gentiles and the tax collector. For after all, Matthew was a tax collector. So he's saying, give it a try again, because this is the most important thing. For what is done here on earth has lasting effects to eternity. Guess what? That person you had a disagreement with, when you get to the pearly gates, who might be inside the gates? Now continuing on. If two of you agree on earth about anything you ask, and I stop there. If two of you agree on earth about anything you ask, how do we ask God for anything? We ask through prayer. And I think that the two people haven't come to an understanding, pray about and for each other. And then Jesus continues, it will be done for you by my Father in heaven. So whatever you ask after this agreement that you have agreed and come together, God is going to grant it. Sometimes we wonder, well, why isn't God answering our prayers? And so what is going on in here? What is going on in here? What's going on in the heart? God is pleased with their reconciliation. There's less upheaval in the kingdom of God. For where two or three are gathered in my name, I am there among them. It is gratifying to know that as we gather together as the church in praise and worship, Jesus is among us. It does not matter the size. If it is a small church of three or a massive mega church, Jesus is present. What is important to Jesus is a faithful heart whose love is genuine enough to reach across the aisle and say to someone, I am sorry. I do believe what is important here is the agreement between the two. As part of the Christian walk, it is important to Jesus that people agree with each other rather than fight all the time. Paul, in later years, found that fights were breaking out in the church, which threatened to undo the work of Jesus and all he, Paul, had done. His letters were not only to encourage the new believers, but also to correct and to discipline. So I read from 1 Corinthians 11. But in the following instructions, I cannot praise you. For it sounds as if more harm than good is done when you meet together. First, I hear that there are divisions among you when you meet as a church. And to some extent, I believe it. When you meet together, you're not really interested in the Lord's Supper. For some of you hurry to eat your own meal without sharing with others. As a result, some go hungry, while others get drunk. What? Don't you have your own homes for eating and drinking? Or do you really want to disgrace God's church and shame the poor? What am I supposed to say? Do you want me to praise you? Well, I certainly will not praise you for this. Boy, talk about Paul being upset. He's upset with the behavior of the church at Corinth, for the way in which they first do not share with everyone, and secondly, the cavalier manner in which they eat the body and blood of Christ. So not much has changed between the time Jesus taught this lesson and Paul scolding the churches. I thought that that was very interesting. And I can tell you, I am sure it is still continuing to this day. So, how many times in your lifetime have you said, and still continue to say, I am sorry? How genuine was your apology? In the church, we are good at illusions of harmony. Smiles on the outside while steaming on the inside over this or that. Oh, the usher's greeting was weak. I don't like what the pastor said this morning. Maybe she was talking about me. And Gertrude had the nerve to comment on my potato salad I brought last week. Oh my goodness. I have heard some good stories. And don't be surprised, because Jesus has heard it all. He has heard every complaint you have made. And so it is no surprise. He is saying this morning, if our love is to be genuine, if our minds are to be conformed, we need to act differently. And from this morning's epistle, it is time to lay aside the works of darkness and put on the armor of light. We can only do so when we care enough about the other person to act maturely and cross the room and say, I am sorry, for I did not understand when. It takes courage to make that move. But think of what is at stake here. The entire church. Churches have crumbled because of misunderstandings, honest deeds done to one another. Families have been destroyed because of misunderstandings of something said to one family member. And the battle lines are drawn. Yes, Jesus knows what is at stake here. Our salvation is at stake, for each individual person is a member of the body of Christ. How each person acts, what they say, has a direct effect on the church and on their own salvation. We all have people we need to reach out to. On the website for the Episcopal Church, I found, and I quote, as the Episcopal branch of the Jesus movement, we dream and foster and work to foster beloved communities where all people may experience dignity and abundant life and see themselves and others as beloved children of God. One thing that COVID-19 provided for us is the time and space to rediscover our families, the people we spend with day and day out with. We can no longer use the excuse of being too busy to neglect responsibilities, which got 1% of our time. Becoming beloved communities starts at home. To teach our children who is in their family, who is in their neighborhood, who is in their world. To teach how we should show love to someone who does not look like me or speak like me. We all, regardless of what we look like or who we are, all want love. For each person to acknowledge the other as a human being with wants and desires just like the next person. We all want health, a job, a place to live, to be the best that we can be. This is also a good time to tell our children about our faith. Who is God? Who is Jesus Christ? Why do we come to church? Why do we pray? Bring your children to God and to his Son, Jesus Christ. Let them understand why this is an important part of your life, of their life. Do not say, oh, they will make that choice for themselves when they grow up. How can they know to do that when they have not been taught? How do they become the beloved community if they do not know what baptism is about? For there's where it begins, with our baptismal covenant. We are asked, will you strive for justice and peace among all people and respect the dignity of every human being? Jesus is showing us the way. And our response, I will with God's help. Only through a relationship and prayer can we attain the wherewithal to do so. Loving takes time. Many will not understand. Many will not be willing. But attempt to try. What is Jesus teaching us today? He's shown us how to start to be the beloved community called the Kingdom of God. Jesus says, reach out, go to the person, and build a bridge. For when you build that bridge, you walk across it, and you will bring someone back with you. My friends, I say, go, build, and bring back. Jesus is watching and loving us all the way. Amen.
Amen.
Would you please stand and let us affirm our faith in the saying of the Nicene Creed.
We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, life from life, true God from true God, begotten not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified on the Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again. And according to the scriptures, he ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and Son. With the Father and Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Please kneel as you're able for prayers of the people. In peace, let us pray to the Lord, saying, Lord, have mercy. For the Holy Church of God, especially the rectors, vestries, and members of St. Peter's Church, Lake Mary, St. Francis of Assisi Church, Lake Placid, the Anglican Church of Southern Africa, that it may be filled with truth and love, and be found without fault at the day of your coming. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For Michael Curry, our presiding bishop, Justin Welby, Archbishop of Canterbury, Gregory Dror, our own Bishop Thabo Makagoba, Archbishop of Cape Town, for all bishops and other ministers, and for all the holy people of God, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For all who fear God and believe in you, Lord Christ, that our divisions may cease and all may be one, and as you and the Father are one, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the mission of the church, that in faithful witness it may preach the gospel to the ends of the earth, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For those who do not yet believe, and for those who have lost their faith, that they may receive the light of the gospel, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace of the world, that a spirit of respect and forbearance may grow among nations and peoples, for the well-being and protection of those serving in our country's armed forces, that they may serve with justice and promote the dignity and freedom of every person. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For those in positions of public trust in this nation and the world, especially Donald, our president, Ron, our governor, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For all who live and work in this community, especially the mayor, commissioner, first responders, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For our blessing upon all human labor and for the right use of the riches of creation, that the world may be freed from poverty, famine, and disaster, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the poor, the persecuted, the sick, and all who suffer, for prisoners, refugees, for persecuted Christians everywhere, and all who are in danger, that they may be relieved and protected, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For this congregation, for those who are present, and for those who are absent, that we may be delivered from the hardness of heart and show forth your glory in all that we do. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For all who have commended themselves to our prayers, for our families, friends, and neighbors, that being freed from anxiety, they may live in joy, peace, and health. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For members of our church, for Barbara Campanero, Virginia Warner, Ed and Sandy Vaughn, Sandy Erickson, Beth Anyas, Rose Garcia, Mary Jo McDonald, Sandy Giles, Marjorie Mays, Judy Daroff, Michael Pascarella, Marissa Bears, Janet Marcy Hazen, Sandy Burkhart. For family and friends of Christ Church, Barbara Hartman, Pamela Vaughn, Lawrence Grantham, Helene Markovitz, Lorraine Anthony, Arthur Dash, Walter Redmond, Barry Chase, Christine Russo, Nathan Potter, Ernie Whitehall, Mary White, Carol Estelman, Brenda Smearsmith, Agnes Raffington. And for those who you will name out aloud or in the silence of your hearts. Ken and Cassie Beckham. Novella Penick. Audrey Afton. For those who are in their homes or hospitals with the COVID-19, pray for healing, Lord. The doctors, nurses, and those behind the scenes, for renewed strength for them, Lord. For the researchers and the pharmaceutical companies who are researching vaccines and medication to eradicate this virus. We also pray for those who have been hurt in
latest unrest in various states, for those who have been affected by natural disasters, the fires in California, the hurricanes in Texas and Louisiana. For anyone who has found themselves hurt at this time, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For all who have died in the communion of your church, those who have died from the COVID-19, unrest, natural disasters, violent deaths, and those whose faith is known to you alone, that with all the saints they may have rest in that place where there is no pain or grief, but life eternal. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Rejoicing in the fellowship of all the saints, let us commend ourselves and one another and all our life to Christ our God.
To you, O Lord, our God.
For yours is the majesty, O Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Yours is the kingdom and the glory and the power, now and forever. Amen. Amen. Let us now confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you
in thought, word, and deed. By what we have done, and by what we have left undone.
We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy upon you. Forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ. Strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. Please be seated. Are there any birthdays or anniversaries this week?
It's not my birthday, but Tuesday will be my mom and Henry's birthday.
Okay.
And I would just like to remember them.
Yes.
So mom would be 98 and Henry would be 88.
Okay. Yes, certainly. Anyone else? Chris, can we have the birthday song?
I don't have any volume.
Can we get some volume?
To you, dear Jesus, be true. May the Lord bless and keep you your whole life through.
So I'd like to wish anyone out there on the web and those here, Patty, your family, your husband, mom, a very happy and blessed birthday. And anyone celebrating an anniversary this week, I'd like to say happy anniversary. Remember to keep God in your marriage, and I wish you many, many more years. Okay, would you please stand? The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Hi, everybody.
Do you have what a wonderful world? We have a good song. I see trees of green,
red roses too. I see them bloom for me and you. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world. I see skies of blue and colors white. And brighter days there are here tonight, and I think to myself, what a wonderful world. The colors of the rainbow, the city in the sky, are also on the faces of people going by. I see friends shaking hands, saying, how do you do? Them grow. They'll learn much more than I'll ever know. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world. Yes, I think to myself, what a wonderful world.
Continuing on for Longwood Elementary. So if you have any individual snacks, remember to bring them in. In another couple of weeks, we are hoping to start the renovations here on the chapel. It is very much needed because we are now experiencing some rain coming in our narthex. So the sooner that we can get this started, the better. So if you have not already given to our building fund for the sanctuary, I pray that you will consider doing so, because we're going to need everything that we can get our hands on. Life continues here at Christchurch. We have our Wednesday morning Bible study at 9 o'clock. If anyone would like to join, please let me know. We are doing Exodus 22. So we went right through the book of Genesis, right into Exodus. So please join us if you would like to do so. Lee and myself are going up to the Sharon Center on the 17th. We're going to have lunch and get a tour of the Sharon Center, something that I've wanted to do. I've actually visited, but not formally. So we're going to be formally introduced. And I understand that Christchurch was one of the 17 founders of the Sharon Center 35 years ago. So there's going to be a celebration either later this year or next year for that. So we can listen out for that. I think that is all I have. Elaine, do you have anything?
No.
Okay. We have a vestry meeting on the 16th. And we're hoping from that vestry meeting to put some of the new, to take some restrictions off and add some new things back. But we need to consider how we're going to do that before we let everyone know. So you can keep, I'll keep you posted about that. And we'll still have our Zoom fellowship the last weekend of September. So, none? Yes, Tamara?
Doug Matthews is organizing a meeting this Wednesday at 6 o'clock. I'm not sure where it is, but it's about the Fall Festival. And he has volunteer people to head certain parts of the festival. I'm one of them, so I think he's reached out to everybody in the email. Just wanted to remind.
Right, so those persons will know, okay, other people to help them with their part. The meeting is going to be held, thank you for reminding me, Tamara. The meeting is going to be held here. In the parish hall, we have enough space for everyone to safely social distance. So, and we're starting at 6 o'clock in the evening. So once that meeting takes place, I'll have more information to tell the congregation. Okay? All right. Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself an offering and sacrifice to God. Would you please stand and let us sing our offertory hymn, Kneel at the Feet of Jesus.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord, our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who on the first day of the week overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection, open to us the way of everlasting life. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name.
Thank you.
heaven and earth are. With your glory, Hosanna in the highest.
Blessed is he who comes
in the name.
Therefore, according to his command, O Father, we remember his death. We proclaim his resurrection. We await his coming in glory. And we offer our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving to you, O Lord of all, presenting to you from your creation this bread and this wine. We pray, you gracious God, to send your Holy Spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the sacrament of the body of Christ and his blood of the new covenant. Unite us to your Son in his sacrifice, that we may be acceptable through him, being sanctified by the Holy Spirit. In the fullness of time, put all things in subjection unto you, O Christ, and bring us to that heavenly country where with all your saints we may enter the everlasting heritage of your sons and daughters, through Jesus Christ our Lord, the firstborn of all creation, the head of the church, and the author of our salvation. By him, and with him, and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to sing.
Thank you.
Hallelujah. Christ, our Passover, is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us keep your feast. Hallelujah.
Those who are unable to receive at this time, we have the act of spiritual communion. My Jesus, I believe that you are present in the most holy sacrament. I love you above all things and I desire to receive you into my soul. Since I cannot at this moment receive you sacramentally, come at least. spiritually into my heart. I embrace you as if you are already there. I unite myself wholly to you. Never permit me to be separated from you. Amen. Post-communion prayer. Let us pray. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and you have fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart, through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen.
Amen.
And the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you now and always. Amen. Amen. Would you please stand? Let us sing our final hymn, Victory in Jesus.
Thank you.
get you upset, what are you going to remember? Jesus loves you. And anyone has upset you, what are you going to do? You're going to go to them and you're going to make peace. Okay. So, go forth, my friends. Go, build bridges, and bring them back.
Okay.
All right?
Okay.
Go in peace, to love, and serve the Lord. Hallelujah, hallelujah.
Thanks
be to God.
Hallelujah, hallelujah.